which, now that I think of it, is kind of a problem, since I always feel uncomfortable around crowds. I mean it, I have this fear of enclosed spaces. I everything makes me feel trapped all the time. You know, I always tell myself, there's got to be something better out there, but maybe I think too much. I think everything must go back to the fact that I had a very anxious childhood. You know, my mother never had time for me. You know, when you're the middle child in a family of 5 million, you don't get any attention. I mean, how is it possible? And I've always had these abandonment issues which plagued me. My father was basically a drone, like I've said, and, you know, the guy flew away when I was just a larva. And my job, don't get me started on, because it really annoys me. I was not cut out to be a worker, I'll tell you right now. I feel physically inadequate. My whole life, I've never been able to lift more than 10 times my own body weight. And when you get down to it, handling dirt is, you know, is not my idea of a rewarding career. It's this whole gung-ho superorganism thing that I... You know, I can't get. I try, but I don't get it. I mean, you know, what is it? I'm supposed to do everything for the colony, and what about my needs? What about me? I mean, I gotta believe there's some place out there that's better than this. Otherwise, I would just curl up in a larval position and weep. The whole system makes me feel insignificant.
Excellent. You've made a real breakthrough.
I have?
Yes, Z. You are insignificant.
I am.
You are insignificant. I love it. I love it. It's one of my favorite movies. And ants. How about Ant-Man? Anybody into comics, Marvel comics? Ant-Man comes out next year around July. There he is. All that's going to be played by Paul Rudd, so it's going to be a real... person. I don't know how that's going to be pulled off, but I saw some clips, and it kind of looks kind of cheesy at this point, but I'm sure they'll make it look really good. And as you may have already guessed, we're going to be talking a lot about ants today. The title of the message is called Of Ants and Men, and our proverb is Proverbs 6:6-9. It says, "Go to the ant, you sluggard. Consider its ways and be wise. It has no commander, no overseer, no ruler, and yet it stores its provisions in summer, gathers its food at harvest. How long will you lie there, you sluggard? When will you get up from your sleep?" So, I don't know about you, but I see this as being very humorous. And God uses humor in the Bible quite often to make a point. And when it comes to the sluggard, God is really, he's got his comic game on in this one. We can smile at the thought of God asking a sluggard to compare his life to that of a tiny insect that most of us consider to be a pest, not a role model. And the laughs just keep coming because Proverbs 26:14 compares a sluggard continually turning over in his bed to a hinge continually turning over in a door, on a door hinge. That's a great visual, isn't it? Like squeak, 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 squeak. And we get more of a belly laugh in Proverbs 26:15 when it tells us that a sluggard has no trouble getting his hand into the dish. Why? Because it's just gravity. It takes no effort to get into the dish. But getting his hand back to his mouth to actually have the reward of eating is not going to happen because that takes work. And Proverbs 26:13, my favorite, is that one of the excuses a sluggard will use to avoid doing something is, hey, I could bump into a lion in the street, and I'm not going to go do that, right? So it's funny, and that could happen. I mean, especially here in Boulder, I've been out running in the foothills, and I've bumped into a mountain lion, a cougar, one time up in Allen Park. It's a little threatening, so that could get you paranoid. Can you make your house bound? It could also be hit by a falling meteorite or be abducted by aliens. That could happen, too. And so, God, when you think about it, you know, this using this really funny material is funny, but don't be misled by the humor, okay? God doesn't use humor so that you and I can laugh at someone. God uses humor so that we can laugh at ourselves. That's why God uses humor. Every great comic knows that the best way to get laughs is to use material that the audience can personally identify with. That's what Robin Williams did so well. That's why we loved him so much, and he made everybody laugh because he was meddling with us all the time. But of course, the author of life, God himself, is the master comic. No one knows how to work a room, or the universe for that matter, better than God. And when truth is humorously portrayed, it not only makes it easier for us to remember the message, it also disarms us and sets us up for the full force of the indictment that's being made that lies just below the surface of the humor. Because while we're still laughing to the point of maybe even, you know, wetting our pants, we begin to realize that the message of the story is not aimed at someone else, it's aimed at us. And by laughing, we betray our own guilt. And once cleverly unmasked, we're tasked with the uncomfortable necessity now of facing this newly discovered reality within ourselves. And so in some way, maybe in many ways, we're all sluggards, not wanting to leave the comfort of our beds, you know. And I thought third service, you'd get this one more than first service. You know, first service, they're here, you know, a lot of them are here by 8 o'clock. You know, they're already out of bed like me, 4 in the morning. You guys, I don't know, maybe you went for a run this morning. Maybe you just got up 10 minutes ago. That's probably my guess. But we're all sluggards in some way, not wanting to leave the comforts of our beds and making all kinds of excuses to avoid the responsibilities that we have in this world. And with this in mind, let's turn our attention to the sluggard as he portrayed in the book of Proverbs. And let's do so knowing that there are valuable lessons for us to learn, not just about ourselves, not about others, but for ourselves as well. And we're going to look at what I believe are the two primary characteristics of a sluggard. And keep in mind that I believe it takes both these characteristics to really create an accurate picture of what makes up a sluggard. And as usual, as we look at these two primary characteristics, take an inventory of your own life and see how much of this, if anything, applies to you. And so the two primary characteristics of a sluggard is this. Number one, he craves comfort. He thrives on comfort. He lives for comfort. But number two, he avoids responsibility. And because both of these characteristics are always in play, thriving for comfort but avoiding responsibility, the sluggard rarely gets what he craves for because he has no follow-through. That's why it says in Proverbs 26:15, he can make it down to the dish, that's easy, but he can't get the food back up to his mouth. He's got no follow-through. Proverbs 13:4 is a great verse that captures both of these characteristics. It says the sluggard craves, but he gets nothing. Is that sad and pathetic at the same time? Proverbs 21:25 says it this way, the sluggard's craving implied there for comfort will be the death of him because his hands refuse to work. And so he, on one hand, God, I just want to stay comfortable. I want to stay in my bed. I want to, you know, just get up into the womb position here, the fetal position in the womb. But then he's got no follow through to be able to make it happen. So now, because the sluggard's primary characteristics are to crave comfort and to avoid responsibility, there's a few secondary traits that are usually attributed to him. For instance, he's typically thought of as being lazy. And if you think about it, as he's described in the book of Proverbs, the sluggard has one and only one tool in his toolbox, and that's his bed, which is why Proverbs 26:14 compares the sluggard turning over in his bed to a door turning over on its hinges. But don't be fooled, because the bed is even though it's meant literally in some sense, it's mostly meant to be a metaphor about how much time is wasted during a sluggard's lifetime doing meaningless, shallow things in life rather than finding ways to make a real difference in this world for himself, for others. And so laziness in the sluggard's case basically equates to a shallow existence. So think of laziness that way. It's just living life in a shallow existence. Another secondary trait of a sluggard is that he's a chronic procrastinator. Can you guess what day of the week is the favorite day of a sluggard? Who said? I heard it say, tomorrow. Tomorrow is always the favorite day. His favorite motto is, never do today what you can put off until tomorrow. The sluggard intends to do something, every day he intends to do something, but he actually doesn't get around to do it. And he's not only developed this ability to put off starting a task, if he does have to do something, he's also developed the ability to putting off completing that task as well. He has an endless list of excuse, even beyond there's lions in the street, you know. How about, is it spring forward or is it fall back? I can't remember. I got kind of confused there. Or I couldn't get rid of those Jehovah's Witnesses in my living room. You know, I got stuck in that blood pressure tester at King Supers. I just couldn't get out. He's just got one excuse after the other. And the sad thing is that a slugger is very well aware that he has a problem with procrastination, but he won't have time to actually get some help about it until tomorrow. Yeah, okay. Another secondary trait of a slugger is that he's a skimper. He skimps on things. He takes shortcuts. He cuts corners. He's the king of loopholes. And when the sluggard can no longer avoid doing something, he'll always take the easiest, the cheapest, and the quickest path, often violating safety rules, even breaking laws, in order to find the path of least resistance. And then finally, the last secondary trait of a sluggard is that he's apathetic. He's just indifferent to the cares and needs around him, including his own. And he's oblivious to the things in life that need attention, whether it's something that needs to be fixed, a bill that needs to be paid, pets that need care, assignments need to be completed, and all the people around him, including strangers that you just bump into, that have obvious needs. And so the primary characteristics of a sluggard is that he craves comfort and he avoids responsibility. And then this self-destructive lifestyle leads to these secondary traits that make him lazy, procrastinator, a skimper. I love that, a skimper, and apathetic. And I would bet that at this point of the message, you're all sitting there, because I could see, I love seeing the body language in people. I would bet that at this point in the message, just like it was for first service, and just like it was for second service, most of you are thinking about someone in your lives who's a sluggard, right? But I'm guessing that probably not many of you, if not any of you, are thinking that these characteristics or traits apply to you. I was thinking that this week as I was studying that. But as usual, no one here at Cornerstone escapes a Sunday morning unscathed. And this is not going to be one of those mornings where it's going to be unusual. And that will become more apparent as we look at the characteristics of ants. Ants. Go to the ant, you slugger. Because, listen to this, the true litmus test of whether or not we are sluggards hinges not on how often we turn in our beds, but how often we pattern our lives after the ant. And so as we read in Proverbs 6:6, go to the ant, consider its ways, and be wise. And so let's go to the ant, consider its ways so that we can be wise. Because after all, the title of this series is called Sophia, the Beauty of Wisdom. Sophia means wisdom. And according to Proverbs, the ant antics are the antidote to sluggish behavior, okay? In case you didn't know, well, and you know, I had so much fun the last couple of weeks. I've been watching ant documentaries. And what's really weird is Andrew will vouch for this. We've had this problem with ants in our house lately. I mean, you know, in California, you have lots of trouble. You leave food out for 5 minutes and you've got thousands of ants that just come. I mean, it's like their communication system is incredible. Food at the binders. We're in, you know. Colorado, you don't see, I mean, you see ants, they're like seasonal. I never even heard of seasonal ants. They like come out, you know, they just disappear in the wintertime and they like pop out and they're there for like a week. You know, sometimes in my driveway, they come up through cracks and things. They're gone. Well, this year, for the first year, we have ants in our kitchen. And the last 2 weeks, you know, I don't know why God puts these things in my life that are relevant to these messages. I've been killing ants, like, until I started watching that clip and I realized, oh, wait, these guys are like, they're my buddies. I shouldn't be killing them. But you can't relocate them like you can prairie dogs. So Honestly, I've just been stepping on them and killing them, you know. But if you're not aware of it, ants, and particularly ant colonies, are amazing super communities. I mean, Z there, played by Woody Allen, called it a super organism. I just don't get the whole super organism thing. And they're often made up of millions upon millions of ants. I mean, they have discovered some to be as large as 400 million ants, all living together in one subterranean household. How would you like to have that for a family? And the basic ant colony is divided into, first of all, the queen. We're all aware of the queen. And most people have a misunderstanding that the queen is like throwing out orders. You know, you go there, you go there, you go there, you give me a massage, you know. But as Solomon got it right, ants have no commanders, no leaders, no rulers. Everybody knows what to do. They know what their role is. They know what to do. They communicate mostly by pherons. Those. And it's kind of an amazing communication system. The queen only has one function, and it's to lay eggs. And then there's patrolling ants. The patrollers make sure that they go out early in the morning before the sun gets out, and they make sure that it is safe to go out, because the next group that's going to come out are going to be the foragers. The foragers are going to go out, and they're going to go gather food. I mean, you got to feed 350 million people. You better get out early if you're going to make that happen. And so they communicate with each other, and it's not just the smell. So they know which function each ant does by the smell. Oh, you're a forager, you know. And the foragers won't go out until the patrollers come back, and they have to come back in a certain timing. Like if they come back every 10 seconds, yeah, it's good to go. But if they come back like every minute, it's like, no, it's not safe. This is how they communicate. And then you have the maintenance ants, and their job is to keep the dirt tunnels in good shape. That's what Z was doing. Ooh, dirt. You know, I'm just not made for dirt. And they've got to kind of make sure that everything is passable and usable. And then you've got what I think is worse than the maintenance ants, or the refuse ants. They're the ones who's got to get all the yucky waste out from the tunnels into the dung heap, which is outside of the colony. By the way, all those groups I just mentioned, all of those divisions of ants are females, 100% females. Male ants only live for a couple of weeks. Guess what their job is? Their job is to mate with the queen, and then they go off and they die. How's that for a life? I know there's some men here going, that'd be a pretty cool job. And it could be the dream job of the male ant species, or it could be like a sort of a cruel joke on males by Mother Nature, a female, right? You know, we're always being attacked that way. But in either case, whether you live for 2 weeks or you live for a year, every ant in the colony only lives and only dies for one reason and one reason alone, and that's for the welfare and the survival of the entire community. And despite that clip that I showed that highlights what appears to be a very discontent and insignificant feeling ant named Z, ants appear to be very satisfied living in the role that they've been tasked within the community to ensure the welfare and the survival of the community. There are no sluggards in an ant community. No ants crave comfort. No ant avoids responsibility. There's no lazy ants. There's no procrastinating ants. There are no skimper ants, and there are no apathetic ants within the community. Every ant in the colony understands his or her unique role within the community, and they all work together for the welfare and survival of the community, and there's no leader telling them to do it. And this is why the sluggard should go to the ant and consider their ways so that he can be wise. And when you think about a sluggard in terms of his role or lack of his role
to help ensure the welfare and the survival of the community, we can now ask ourselves, what kind of communities are we part of? And do we exhibit any sluggard type traits in any of those communities? And let me give you just a few communities to think about that most of us are part of, like your family, for instance, or your group of friends, or your workplace environment, classroom if you're a teacher or a student, playgroup if you're you have young kids, the church, the congregation, your place of worship. How about the neighborhood you live in? That's a community. Or a sports team that you might play on. How about the city you live in? Here we're in the city of Boulder. This is our community. You might live in Broomfield. That's your community. You might live in Erie. That's your community. How about the nation? We are a community of Americans. And we can expand it all the way out to the world. We are a community of humanity. And when we think of our lives more about belonging to a collection of various communities, it's easier then to see how we might have some sluggard traits in one or more of them. We might not have sluggard traits in our family. You might be a great family person. You might take all that responsibility really well. You might be a great... You might not have any sluggard traits in your workplace environment. Man, you go to work every day. You get there on time. You know, you're diligent. You get everything done. You come home. But what about working together for the welfare and survival of your neighborhood? Or your city? Or globally? The cares of the world? Or is craving for comfort and the avoidance of responsibility making us lazy, procrastinators, skimpers, and apathetic? And are we asleep in our bed, so to speak? Turning over and over again like a door on its hinges, thinking someone else will represent God in those communities. Someone else got it covered. And this is why Solomon writes in the Proverbs, "Go to the ant, consider its ways, and be wise." Don't be unwise, be wise. Speaking of a sleepy church, the Apostle Paul once said in Ephesians chapter 5, verse 14 and 17, he says, wake up, O sleeper. Rise from the dead, and Messiah will shine on you. Be very careful then how you live. Don't live as unwise. Don't be a sluggard in this world. But be wise. Be like an ant. What do ants do? They make the most of every opportunity because the days are evil. Man, if you let your guard down, you're going to be kept caught off guard. Therefore, don't be foolish, but understand what the Lord's will is. So I think most of you would know the name Keith Green. Is that ring a bell for most of you? Keith Green would have been, if he was still alive, he died in 1982, he'd probably be around my age. He was quite a force in the 60s and 70s, kind of a hippie-ish kind of guy that the Lord just caught his life, and he was such a passionate follower of Jesus that just everything, you know, his breath and his blood and his sweat, everything just oozed out in passion. And it showed up a lot in his music. He had kind of in-your-face kind of music, but in a good way. He would provoke you. You'd be listening to it, and you'd go, you know, this guy is just meddling with me. But in a good way. And he wrote this. I love this. This is what he said. He said, "I repent of every of ever having recorded one single song and ever having performed one concert if my music and, more importantly, my life has not provoked you into godly jealousy or to sell out more completely to Jesus. I love that. I mean, that's how he lived his life. And one of my favorite Keith Green songs is called Asleep in the Light. Isn't that a great visual? Asleep in the Light. We have all been pulled out of the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of light, and yet you can still fall asleep in the kingdom of light. And it's easy to fall asleep in the kingdom of light. Comfort. I don't want to be uncomfortable. Give me my blankie. Somebody else is taking care of it anyways. And so this past week I had Sean Hart put some pictures to that music that kind of match God's heart in the world here at Cornerstone Church, things that we're involved in, and it's going to meddle a little bit. So let's just watch it. And as you watch it, by the way, listen to the words. Keith Green was quite a wordsmith. Listen to the words and then watch, you know, match the pictures to those words. But more importantly, let the Holy Spirit speak to you as you sit in your seat, okay? Here we go.
See all the people sinking down. Don't you care? Don't you care? Are you gonna let them drown? How can you be so numb not to care if they come? You close your eyes and pretend the job's done. Oh, bless me, Lord. Bless me, Lord. You know, it's all I ever hear. No one aches, no one hurts, no one even sheds one tear. But he cries, he weeps, he bleeds, and he cares for your needs. And you just lay back and keep soaking it in. Streets. Open up, and give yourself away. You see the need, you hear the cries, so how can you delay? God's calling, and you're the one, but like Jonah, you're on. He's told you to speak, but you keep holding it in. Church just can't fight, 'cause it's asleep in the light. How can you be so dead when you've been so well fed? Jesus rose from the grave.
Andrew and I lived in the same city that Keith Green lived in San Fernando Valley in California, Tarzana, and probably lived, you know, about a half a mile from where his place was, but we were not believers back then. We never crossed paths, and we were as far away from the kingdom of God as you could be back then, living for ourselves. And, you know, these are interesting times that we live in. There's a lot to be afraid about, isn't there? There's a lot to want to stay in that comfort zone and to just crawl into bed and to sleep there with your blankie and put it over your head and just not get into the game, so to speak. But that's what this message is about, you know, that I think the real application of this message is, how are we living as ants in the communities that we're involved in? And just think about those communities that you're involved in your own life, your workplace, your home, your neighborhoods, your family, your city, the world. There's so much going on in this world, and some of it's scary. And we don't know where it's going to go or how fast it's going to get to where it's going. But we're the ones that God has called. That's what this is about. Wake up, O sleepers, and rise from the dead. And let the light of Messiah shine on you. And do not live as unwise, but as wise, making the most of every opportunity, for the days are evil. And do not be foolish, but understand what the Lord's will is. What's his will? To bring the kingdom of heaven on earth, to bring God's kingdom on earth as it is in heaven. As much as we can until the Messiah returns. And so, by way of an application, I just want to ask those of you this morning who have felt kind of a conviction of the Holy Spirit in your heart, to stand up, kind of a metaphorical getting out of your bed. Rise up. By the way, that's what that word was in Ephesians. Rise up. It literally means wake up, awaken. That one that Paul said. Wake up. The time is near. And so if you want to kind of make a statement before God that this is a game-changing day for you, then stand up along with everybody else that's standing. That from this day forward, see, I haven't even said what it means yet. You guys are all standing. I love that. This is what it means. That from this day forward, God, give me the kind of eyes that I need to see within the communities that you have placed me, to be your light, to be your counselor, to bring the good news of the gospel to the people in this world who need it so much. And I'm not going to wait for the commander-in-chief of Cornerstone Church to create a program. I'm an ant. I don't need a commander-in-chief. You, Lord, are my commander-in-chief. And so together, Lord, me and you, through the power of the Holy Spirit, to break every chain, going to do whatever I can in those communities to bring the light and the love that you have put in my heart to pass on. And I'm going to get out of my comfort zone to do it. And I'm not going to avoid the responsibility. I'm not going to think that somebody else is going to do it. And so, Father, I pray that you would seal this in our hearts today, that this would be a game-changing day, that we would literally get in the game, and that you would work through us, that your power would work through us, and so we would wake up, you sleepers, and stand up, you dreamers, and raise up hands, all believers. In the name of Yeshua, our Messiah. So let's go out and let's sing that song again. Everybody else, stand up now.